So welcome to today's lecture. Today we will talk about monitoring alpine solifluction. And I prepared a lecture based on six different points that we will discuss point after point. And I will directly start with a short introduction about what alpine solifluction is. And the basis of today's lecture is a paper I published in 2021. It's increasing the spatiotemporal resolution at monitoring alpine solifluction using terrestrial laser scanners and 3D vector field. And this paper is open access. You can download here. And as I said, this will be the basis of today's lecture. I will not tell today about all the options that are available to monitor alpine solifluction or to monitor other landslides. So there is a large variety of methods and instruments you could potentially use. I will not give an overview about this. I will just focus on this paper and how we did it, and based on the measurements, how you can process them and get the results out you maybe want to have. So there might be other, or there are definitely other options available to also monitor solifluction, but they are not addressed today. The learning objectives of today's lectures are how to monitor alpine solifluction, why combining different strategies, and how to identify landslides and point clouds. So in the end of the lecture, you should be able to answer those questions. Coming back to the agenda, I now want to start with point one, alpine solifluction and the study area. So, at first, I want to introduce the definition of a solifluction. So solifluction is a collective name for gradual processes in which a mass moves down a slope related to freeze-thaw activity. So it's about freeze-thaw, and related to this process, we see that parts of a land or parts of a hill are moving down the hill. You can see here a rough sketch of a so-called solifluctional lobe that consists of a body and a head. And this complete structure moves down the hill into this direction based on the freeze-thaw activity. And now the question is, if we consider some kind of hill, I will just, or a slope, I will show you the position where, that we monitored on the next slide. But if we consider some of this, the questions are, where are those solifluctional processes on the hill or on the slope? Where can I see them? And how fast are they? Are all the lobes that are potentially existent at this slope, do they all move in the same velocity, or are some of them slower or faster? So these are the questions. We want to localize all the solifluctional lobes or the solifluction processes on some hill, on some study area, and we want to quantify how fast do they go down the hill. And to answer those questions, I will propose a strategy that is based on point-based measurements as well as area-based measurements, and also measurements giving an absolute reference frame, so that I can georeference my observations, so that I can also measure some years afterwards. And I would find out if the complete hill moved, for example. Here you can see the study area. It has an extent of about 200 meters in this direction. So this is not the height shown here. This is just the positional quantity in this direction. And in this direction, we have about 120 meters. Here we have about 200 meters. And you can see that this is the study area here. And now we are interested in finding out if these solifluctional processes you can see here, for example, if they move, so if they are active, if they move, they are active, or if they are inactive, so they don't move. And this is the complete study area, and you can see here that just by visual interpretation, you can see that we have some solifluctional lobes here. Here's the lobe head, here's the lobe body, and this might move down the hill. Here's also one. And you can see here that there are also several processes here, maybe here, here, and here also. And now we want to find out, okay, does something move or does it not move? And how fast does it move? These are the questions. And therefore, we went to the study area twice, once in year 2014 and once in 2016, to measure the geometry of this part of this region. And then afterwards, we want to processed the changes in this region to see what changed and how much did it change and where did it change. And therefore, the whole strategy, measuring and interpretation, is called geodetic monitoring, and here is the region based on solifluction. Okay, here's another view of the study area to know in which region it is. It is a region in Austria. You can see here, here's the point in the country Austria, and here's again the picture you saw already before, but now you can see the direction of movement, of the potential movement, because this is the direction down the hill, those two arrows. And here you can also see the oriented study area, where it is located, with the coordinates here on the left. And you can see that the movement is in the direction of north. And this is the coordinate system with the x and y axis we will from now on use to show all the deformations we found out. So this here is the orientation of the picture B. You can see x axis goes in this direction and y axis in this direction. And these are also the axes I showed in the picture before regarding the scale. Okay. So for this region, we want to find out what changed between two different epochs, 2014 and 2016, and we relate this difference, this deformation, to solifluctional processes. Okay, the study area is also quite famous because back of the study area, what you couldn't see now on the picture, there's the house Glora Hütte, which is quite famous for travelers and climbers in this region. And it's also quite famous because we see now the study areas in the back of the picture. We see the Großglockner directly next to the study area. And this is the bottom of the study area, so where the solifluction processes at some point might end up, because here is a planar region. The whole study area has a height of about 2,642 meters. And this is where we stayed twice, 2014-2016, twice a week to monitor the solifluction. Okay, now you got an impression about how the study area looks like. And now we want to have a look at what the monitoring strategy looks like. At first, I want to introduce the deformation model that we used to interpret the data and also as basis for measurements. So you know that there exist four different deformation models that can potentially be used to monitor something. And you can see that there are differences in the fact whether they incorporate time or the acting forces in the modeling equations. And if we talk about landslides, it's quite hard to introduce the acting forces as some parameters in the deformation analysis, since you don't know that accurately whether the source or the reason for the deformation is the rain, is the density of the soil or something. So it would be really hard to model this. This is why if we talk about landslides or natural deformations, we most times don't model acting forces, which would lead to the fact that we either use the congruence model or the kinematic model. And if we just talk about two epochs, we cannot model the time. So we would be in the congruence model. And the congruence model is the most frequently used model to analyze landslides due to the reasons I just said. Thus, we need to assume that the object is sufficiently in equilibrium during the measurements, which you can, since the measurements just take 2 or 3 days, and during this period, if there is not much rain or some other facts that could potentially lead to a deformation within this period, we can assume the object to be sufficiently in equilibrium. A forecast is not possible because we just measure two epochs. Okay, so we will analyze the deformations in the congruence model. A larger differentiation between all those models and a larger or a longer introduction of those models will be given in some other lecture. Okay, congruence model means we want to compare the coordinates or the positions or some parameters of an epoch, of the current epoch t, with the same parameters of a previous epoch t minus 1. So we say they are both identical, considering some measurement noise. And if they are not identical, we can assume that there is some deformation in between. So we want to find out whether the difference between those two states, the parameters of those two states, the difference d, is significantly not zero, or if it's the value that is not zero just due to measurement noise. And to test this, we need to do a significance test, which is here the global test of congruence, where we just want to find out, is the difference d significant or not, considering its uncertainty, the uncertainty of epoch 1 and the uncertainty of epoch 2 expressed by the covariance matrices. So if this test is significant or not, if it's larger compared to some threshold or not, if yes, at least one parameter is deformed, or at least at one position the region is deformed, meaning that the landslide or the solifluction indeed has moved. Okay, so this is the question. The congruence model, has something moved or not? And we can just say yes or no. We cannot interpret the data better considering some acting forces or some temporal behavior, since we just have two epochs. We can just say, okay, within those two epochs, we have a difference of some centimeters or meters or millimeters or whatever. Okay, how will we do this? We realize this using a monitoring strategy that is based on different steps. As I already said in the beginning, we want to combine methods to georeference our data so that we have an absolute position inside the region. We want to find out something about point-based deformations. Therefore, we use established processing strategies. As everybody knows, or everybody who studies geodesy, there is just a well-known catalog of what to do if you want to find out about point-based deformations. Especially if you want to use a congruence model, then you just have to estimate the global test of congruence, and then afterwards localize the deformation if indeed something happened. But also we want to find out about area-based deformations. We want to not only have individual points that can attest some movement, we also want to analyze whether there are in smaller regions, in smaller parts, deformations. And to do this, there is not a well-known established processing strategy. Thus, we need innovative ideas that spread everywhere at the moment to get error-based deformations out of measurements gained by terrestrial laser scanners. This is what I mean with TLS. TPS means total stations or total positioning system, so a total station, a tachyometer. And to do the georeferencing, we use also total station measurements and also GNSS measurements. And based on those measurements, we can build up some kind of classical deformation network or monitoring network consisting of some points that are called reference points that are most probably or really sure outside of the deformed area, so that we can assume that nothing happens there, that you can assume that those positions are absolute and not changing. And also we have some measurements inside the region that is potentially deformed, so where the solifluction process potentially works. And this is then the deformed area here, and there we talk about object points, where we talk about relative measurements. And for those measurements, we use total station and also laser scanner. But they rely on the reference network we somehow need to process based on GNSS and total station measurements. And this is why I introduce in the further precision of this today's lecture the three points that we will first talk about georeferencing, so how to get the network that is stable. Afterwards, we will talk about point-based monitoring. So how can we use a total station to get some deformations out? And then about area-based monitoring, what will be the main aspect of this today's lecture. And afterwards, I will finish with a conclusion. So fixing the geodetic datum. I said we need GNSS measurements and also total station measurements to get a really accurate geodetic network that also has absolute coordinates. And therefore, we positioned ourselves with the total station and also with the GNSS antenna and GNSS receiver on several points we previously marked by ourselves. So we searched in the areas positions in the solid rock where we could fix a measuring bolt or measuring mark to position ourselves. You can see here some point. And those points in the solid rock should not move, or we assume that they won't move since it's solid rock. So we say that those might be the reference points we can rely on. But to assure that they really didn't move, we also measure with GNSS to find out if there was an absolute movement. Okay, and we also used some points given by the federal surveyor from the federal surveying network in Austria. Okay, and you can see that here is also one point which is not in the solid rock. This is in the area which is potentially moved. So we use points in this rock and also points that could potentially move just to improve the network geometry of the geodetic network, so to make the coordinates more reliable and more accurate. But we can afterwards analyze by a classical congruence test whether there was indeed a movement between the years 2014 and 2016 or not. Okay, this was the measuring activity to get the network. So we position ourselves on 9 points where some of them potentially moved and some of them we were quite sure that they won't move. And then we measured with the total station between all those points, and also we position ourselves with GNSS on each point. This needed a lot of instrumentation, and therefore we were quite lucky that there was a cargo cable car that helped us bringing all the equipment up to the Glora Hütte to measure afterwards the network, because otherwise we wouldn't be able with only some people to get all the stuff up the hill here, because we had to leave our car down here and then we had to move this all the way up to the study area. Okay, here are some impressions where we performed the measurements. You can see here that the total station is positioned or is centered right above the measuring bolt that we used for measuring. And you can see here also that we had to cope with some natural circumstances, I can call it, because sometimes we couldn't see the other station to measure to it, so we needed to wait until the fog was gone. And this is one point which is quite up, and you can see here that down here is the measuring or the study area. Here's also some colleague in action. You can see here a bit of the Großglockner behind. So we position ourselves, as I said, on all those points and measured from one point to the other. And afterwards, we did an adjustment, a network adjustment, to get all the coordinates of the 9 points that we wanted to find out for whether they are stable or not. You can see one colleague centering the prism over the reference point. And here again, here was one point, here was one point, and down here is the study area. Okay, so we position ourselves on those 9 points. You can see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And this is the network and the network adjustment where all the measurements of the total station are combined to estimate the coordinates, the three-dimensional coordinates of those 9 points. And this is done for each epoch, so for the year 2014 and then for the year 2016. And afterwards, after each network adjustment, it is searched for deformations. So it is both networks are compared using the global test of congruence to identify potential differences. And if there are differences, those points are sorted out and the network adjustment is recalculated. This is a typical procedure in engineering geodesy. One excursus I want to introduce here, why it's important to also have geodetic background. I wrote down here the atmospheric conditions. We had in September 2014 a temperature of about 2 to 6 degrees Celsius and an air pressure of 740 hectopascal. In 2016 we had a temperature of 12 degrees and air pressure of 745 hectopascal. So you can see that the temperature differs by up to 10 degrees and the air pressure differs not that much. So the question is, why is this important? It is really important because if we use total station measurements, we measure angles and distances between the points. And the distances are measured electro-optically. So a laser beam is sent out of the instrument, reflected by the prism and sent back. And we measure the time that it travels through the atmosphere. And if we have changing atmospheric conditions, the travel speed, the speed of light changes. And this can be important if we talk about those changes. And it's really important since we talk about an air pressure, which is quite low due to the height we have, due to the height of more than 2,600 meters, the air pressure is quite low compared to the air pressure that the standard atmosphere has. Because a total station typically assumes, if you don't tell it otherwise, that it has a temperature outside of 12 degrees and an air pressure of 1013 hectopascal. And now you can see that we have more than 270 hectopascal difference. And we know that a temperature change of 1 degree Celsius leads to 1 ppm distance change, and a change of 3 hectopascal to a change of 1 ppm again. And ppm means parts per million, meaning temperature change of 1 degree or air pressure change of 3 hectopascal leads to a change of the measured distance of 1 parts per million, 1 millimeter per kilometer, or 1 micrometer per meter. And related to the distances we measured, about 100 meters or a bit longer, this means that the temperature, which is different here to this, leads to a change of the distance of about 1 millimeter, the air pressure about 10 millimeters. Here the temperature is as assumed, and the air pressure again is about 10 millimeters. So if I wouldn't correct the measured distance, I would make an error of about 10 millimeters in the distance we have here, or even more. So we would have a scale in the network of about 10 millimeters since the air pressure is really lower compared to what we usually assume in the normal or in the usual heights. So you really need to consider this and correct the distances, and otherwise you get really inaccurate results, and you will see that the 10 millimeters are really important, since we can get a lot better if we would consider this. So obviously we considered this, and if I now do the network adjustment, we get coordinates out for those 9 points I said. So here are the coordinates for those 9 points. They are written down here in a local coordinate system, not in a global one, to be able to better interpret those coordinates. You can see that we got uncertainties for the coordinates of better than 0.2 millimeters in lateral and better than 0.8 millimeters in height. And this is now the uncertainty or the accuracy and the coordinates of epoch 1. And we also get those of epoch 2. And if we now build the differences and see if there are large differences and sort those positions with large differences out and do a calculation and so on, considering geodetic deformation analysis, we get to those final results that we have deltas, so positional differences in position and in height of 1.7 millimeters for 0.1, 1.0 for 0.2, so quite small differences. We would say, okay, they are not significant, but there are also differences in the coordinates of 70 millimeters, 26, 61. And you see that we also have differences in height. And if we now do a significance test, we can see that those are significant, so that we can say that those points here are stable, that have quite small differences between the two epochs. And we have four points that are not stable, because the differences are too large. They are significantly different to epoch one. So we need to sort them out. And you can see that those are the points 3, 4, 5, and 8. And if I now plot this in a graphic, you can see this result. We have the 9 points with the estimated coordinates in the coordinate system that I showed before. And you can see also the differences plotted by a vector between both epochs. And you can see here the scale of the vector, this size here is 10 centimeters. And you can see that the points with the green circle are the ones that are not stable. They moved. You can see that this movement here is about 10 centimeters. And here's also a smaller movement here also. And here also quite small movement. But those four are the ones that moved. And those four points are also the ones that were not positioned in solid rock. So they are in the region that is potentially affected by solifluction. So this is not surprising that those four are indeed moving. But the other ones, the other five did not move. They can assume to be stable. And now you can see here again the points where you say, okay, we have 9 network points. And they are now split in 5 reference points. The 5 red ones that did not move, they have an accuracy of millimeter or even a bit better. And we also have 5 objects points, and those points are moved, or they moved, let's say they moved. And you can see here the potential region that is due to movement, and you can see that those are really lying in this area, and the 0.7 did not move, although it is in this area because it's in solid rock. Okay, so this is the interim conclusion. We now have 5 stable points that can be assumed not to have moved, and we can rely on those. Okay, so now we can do the point-based monitoring just based upon the georeferencing network. So for the point-based monitoring, the idea is we cannot measure the complete object between two epochs, T minus 1 and T, because we can just measure at individual points. So we need to get from this continuous representation into a discrete representation. So the idea is we say we signalize some positions in the object that might have moved between this epoch and this epoch. And then we can just generalize from this discrete movement to the continuous again. So by visualization, we say we use the continuous representation, so the object, the landslide, the solifluction, which we cannot measure completely, we say we just position at some points a reflector, a prism, or something else, and we just measure those discrete points in epoch T minus 1 and also in epoch T. And then we just compute the differences between those points and those points. And we get individual vectors for each point. And then we can generalize from this movement to the complete object in the continuous domain. This is the idea of a point-based deformation analysis. And this is also the idea what was already behind in the reference network that I have showed some minutes before. So also there we discretized the object into several points and then looked at the movement of each individual point. So this idea is now also transformed to get point-based movements of the solifluction. And therefore, we made use of the fact that the geologists measuring there or analyzing this region there have positioned several surface markers. So about 200 or 1 to 200 surface markers looking like this were positioned in the ground, and they are positioned there since several years. And now we just measured the position of those surface markers. And then we can find out if the position of the surface markers changed between 2014 and 2016. So this is a quite easy solution, but you can also see a large handicap for this solution here, because this is an area which is just used by sheep or other people also, climbers, hikers, and they from time to time use such a surface marker and just take it. So there used to be many hundred, and now there are some of them are gone or some of them are located somewhere else. So this is not a really reliable method, since those surface markers could have changed or could have moved or could have been just sticked out by some sheep, as you can see here. But anyway, we used the surface markers that were still present. And you can see here again the network points in red. And now I printed on top the surface markers. So those points which were still there, we measured the different positions in 2014, 2016. You can see here now again the vector with a scale of 10 centimeters. You can see here, this is the scale, to see the deformation. And you can see that we have here an area where there's large deformation here also, and here down also. Again, this here, from here to here, and from here down is the moving direction of the hill. So we can see that we get a good impression about what happened there. We see that the landslide indeed, or the solifluction process indeed, is active. We see some centimeters change, but we don't have a guess what happened here. We don't have a guess what happened here, or what happened here, or here. And why is this much larger than this? Is this an error, or is this indeed so much larger than here? It's also not quite easy to quantify the uncertainty of this method, because we don't know the positional uncertainty of this surface marker that well. But we get a first impression, and we get for several points the impression of what was going on here at these positions. So an interim conclusion could be, we see the surface marker movements of about 50 to 150 millimeters. Partially they are also about 250 millimeters, and the accuracy is about centimeter level. Since we don't know how good the surface markers are really positioned, if they are measured at the same position both times and so on. So I would rather say it's centimeter accuracy. And we measured all those markers from one position. So we positioned ourselves with the total station at one network point and then measured all those surface markers. Okay, quite easy processing scheme, building the difference, considering the uncertainty, but the uncertainty is not that much known for the surface markers. Okay, now we talk about an area-based monitoring. Therefore, we took a laser scanner and just measured the complete surface of this region. So we positioned the laser scanner at 10 to 15 stations and then measured all the surrounding with a quite high resolution to get an impression about the complete surface without sticking to individual points that we previously selected. So we needed to position ourselves and register the laser scans, also using the network points, but also using a lot more positions where we set up reflectors. Okay, the resulting measurement positions you can see here in the top view, where we have again the network points in red. We have the study area where we assume that something moved. We have the surface marker positions here. And we have the laser scanner stations in green in 2014 and the laser scanner stations in blue in 2016. And you can see that some of them are quite similar, the stations, but some of them don't have a correspondence, maybe here. And this relies on the fact that we did not plan those positions really accurately. We just made it based upon our knowledge about where we should be. So we didn't think a lot about a concrete plan. Since it's not that important from our opinion, based on the fact that it was quite or rather planar, and we didn't have any occlusions in this area. Okay, here you can see the positions in 3D, where you also get an impression that the points 1 and 2 are in the region which is quite high compared to the study area. This has all somehow a bit equal level compared to positions 1 and 2 regarding the height. But here again you get an impression that here is the downhill direction. So what do we get out? We get a point cloud out. So we measured at several stations, registered all the stations together, did georeferencing in 2014 and 2016, and this here is the resulting point cloud from 2014. We get a point cloud with millions of points, with intensity information. We didn't do any photos, we just had intensity information due to time limits. And you can see here by the color the backscattered intensity. Red means not so well or low intensity backscattered, green or blue means high intensity backscattered. So it's quite homogeneous, the backscattering or the patterns from the intensity, which is due to the fact that we measured on a natural surface which is covered by stones or grass or some other natural objects. And if we look into a detail view, we again have here the complete view, and now we have here the blue window is B and the black window is A. And you can see here again that we have some small patterns in the intensity information, and this is just grass here. You can see also a photo. Maybe we have here a bunch of grass which is shown here, and a stone maybe here. A stone will most probably reflect better than grass, so stone might be the green blue star colors, and red should be the grass. But you can see that it's hard to identify special objects or something, or to build correspondences. And now the question is how to get the deformation out of these point clouds. And therefore exist several methods or several strategies that are implemented or invented in the last years to get out deformations out of point clouds. There's also a lecture available for me where I explicitly talk about monitoring based on point clouds. Now I will just relate this to monitoring soil effluxion or monitoring landslides. I named three approaches or three different categories of approaches A, B, and C in the lecture monitoring based on point clouds, and here I will just stick to method A and B, the surface-based approach and the feature or point-based approach you will see afterwards. But in the surface-based approach, the idea is, again, we have an object at an epoch t minus 1, and we just measure the complete object with a point cloud. So since we do not need to identify, or since we do not need to position at individual points, we don't need to get into the discrete domain as if we would use point-based measurements. So here we have the complete point cloud in green at epoch t minus 1, and if the object deformed, we also have the complete point cloud, and now we have the two point clouds and just need to find out what happened in between. Are there geometric changes? And therefore, the idea in the surface-based approach is we take the point cloud as a whole, we don't have any semantic information of the individual points, and we want to find out geometric changes for nearly each point on the point cloud. This is the idea. And what can be done? Okay, we take the complete point cloud or some derived products. We can smooth it, or we can locally average points, or use freeform surfaces, or whatever. But we take nearly the complete point cloud, and we take each point from the point cloud, x, this is now each point that represents the object, and we want to find out what happened. And therefore, we have two variants. Variant 1 says we want to just find the correspondence of each point in this point cloud to the point in the point cloud here, and then just build the difference. And this is the difference we analyze. This will lead to point cloud comparisons. Or variant B would be, we just build correspondences, maybe small patches, and estimate local transformation parameters. See what changed in between by estimating parameters, transformations. And this will lead to a local ICP, to a local iterative closest point algorithm. And both strategies have been followed in this example, so I will show both results. Regarding the variant one, we have the point cloud comparison. A point cloud comparison typically assumes that we have two epochs and we just want to find out in the point cloud what changed. And you can see here one example, we have two epochs, the dashed line is the true surface, then we have epoch one, which is blue, and epoch two, which is green. And the point cloud comparison now finds for each blue point a corresponding green point and then just calculates the difference, which is the vector in red. So this is the idea. And if no deformation exists, the difference will never be zero. Also, if no deformation exists due to the sampling density, due to random errors and so on. But if a deformation exists, then we have locations where we indeed have a deformation here or here, where the differences between the two points and the two point clouds will increase. And now we can see that here the area is deformed and here maybe not. Okay, but this is the idea of a point cloud comparison. But if we talk about a landslide or a solifluction, this idea here that it deforms into this direction is not really workable, because this is a so-called out-of-plane deformation, where we say the deformation is perpendicular to the surface that we measured on. So in this direction, if this is the surface here, then the deformation is in this direction, so perpendicular, so it's out of plane. And for out of plane deformation, this might work quite well. But here, rather, the situation is we have our solifluction lobe, which looks like this. And now it moved into some direction. And what does not happen is that all the vectors increase, because the correspondences between both point clouds are made after the deformation. So what indeed happens is this. This is what comes out of a point cloud deformation if we talk about in-plane deformations. So we have regions here where the vector is quite long, indicating that we have a deformation. But we also have regions where the vectors are small, although we also have a deformation because it just shifted in this direction. What I want to point out with this is, if we have a surface which is quite planar, and we have a movement along this planar surface, the point cloud comparison would not find it out. It just finds it out if we have some curved object. Then we will see it. And since this structure here is quite similar to a lobe, you can see that we will find out at the lobe head if something changed, because this is the head, but we would not find out if the body changed, because this is a planar smooth surface, and if we move it along this direction, we won't see anything. So this is a problem with the point cloud comparison if we talk about landslides and solifluction, natural surfaces. And this also explains the result we see here. So this is the result of a point cloud comparison here using a strategy called M3C2. Everybody can process by its by my own based on free software. And we get a pattern here. This is all the point cloud comparison with the colors indicating the length of the vector. We just get the length, not the vector itself. You can see here that we have differences of up to 70 millimeters plus and minus. You can see that there are large regions green, meaning that there didn't change anything. But the problem is we don't know if something changed, because if the surface is planar, which it is at many positions, then we would also get a zero even if we had a large movement of some meters, due to the fact that it's an in-plane deformation. But what we see is we have those reoccurring patterns of a red and yellow area and the following blue area. So this is the downhill direction again. Here we have again red area, blue area, red area, blue area, red area, blue area, red area, blue area. So this happens red, blue, quite frequently. And this is a hint to that there is a low pad, because red area means the low pad moved down, we have an increase of mass, and blue means the head is gone, we have a decrease of mass. So here's the head now, and here it is gone, so plus and minus. This we see, but we don't see the soliflexional body. And this can also be answered, or this can be better explained by just using some section of the point cloud. Here, this is just some section of a point cloud. Green is 2014, red is 2016. And you can see here a really moving lobe. This is the lobe's head. And you can see that the lobe moved down about 70 millimeters. And here we would have the changing area, red, and here green. So this explains the reoccurring patterns in the point cloud comparison. But this also explains that the quantities we get out of the point cloud comparisons are not really valid. And we just cannot say if in the regions that are green, really nothing happened or not. So it's only limitedly usable in this example. But now the idea was, okay, we cannot use the point cloud comparison to get really valid numbers of the deformation, but we can use it to identify positions where something changed, and then we use these local surface patches where something changed with the reoccurring patterns of red and blue to do a local iterative closest point algorithm, so to estimate the transformation parameters between two epochs. And this is done here. So the idea is we just take out those slices of the point cloud that we found out for before using the point cloud comparison that something changed, and then process the parameters that explain their change by a local ICP. So we use the iterative closest point algorithm that is invented to transform two point clouds on each other. So considering we have a point cloud here and a point cloud here, the ICP would merge those two, register, merge, whatever, by estimating the parameters. So those two are merged to one complete. And now we use this to estimate the parameters that explain what changed. And so the idea is we use the point cloud comparison, which is shown again here. And here is this position here is enlarged here on the right side. And you can see here again the patterns red and blue. So we use those patterns to identify 10 soliflexion heads. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, indeed 10. So we identified them based on the point cloud comparison and said, okay, in this area there has something changed. We identified soliflexional heads, and now we use a slice from this area to estimate the parameters, rotation and translation, to merge the two point clouds, 2014 and 2016, in this area, and to see what changed by parameters. If we do this, we get those values out for those two, for those 10 soliflexion lobes. Here are the 10, here are the coordinates where they are located in the reference network, and here are the changes in lateral and height. So we see for those 10 lobes that we have changes of 30 millimeters, 62, 64 are the largest numbers in position. And we can see also the changes in height. And we, approximated an accuracy of about 2 millimeters for this strategy. This is more an approximation than a true variance propagation. Okay, and what can we see? We see that we can indeed estimate numbers, but those numbers are rather small compared to the ones before. And we can see that we also have changes in height, and they are all plus changes, meaning that the soliflexional lobe increased in height. So they got up the hill. And this is a problem using this strategy, because if we fit those two point clouds together, the ICP rather shifts the second epoch a bit up, because then it fits better to the point cloud from 2 years before, since we also have a change in shape a bit. And this change in shape makes the ICP lift the point cloud up the second epoch, and obviously those values here are not valid or not representing the reality, since the solid fluxion lobe moved down the hill. So we have a bit of an error in this measurement here, and these values here also most probably a bit underestimated, since we have a larger movement shown by the surface markers. And we can also compare this with the method I will show in the next slides. Okay, but the general results for the local IFCP you can see here graphically. So we again have our study area, we have our network points gained by total station in the network adjustment, we have our surface markers in green, and now we also have our local ICP indicating for those 10 solid fluxion lobe heads what happened there. And you can indeed see that those values are rather small compared to the ones indicated by the surface markers next to. So here is an good example where the ICP shows a really smaller number than the surface markers. And the problem will be that we have an underestimation here. Okay, so this was the strategy using the surface-based approach. Now we can also use a point-based approach to get information out of the point cloud to identify deformations. Here the idea is, okay, I again have the object, I measure the object with the point cloud in two epochs, but now I want to reduce the point cloud to selected points or to features, and each feature can be provided with semantic information. So we know what each feature is, a stone or something else. This is an option. This is not always the case if we talk about features and feature detection, but it can be. So the idea is that we get geometric changes only for individual points, but those points are quite accurate, and we can use those points to attest deformations instead of the complete point cloud. So the idea would be I get individual points in the point cloud and then track the deformations for each point. This is an approach which is quite similar to the original one if we talk about point-based measurements in the beginning with the total station, but the difference is we get those points out of the point cloud and we have much more than if we would use just the total station. So we have our complete point cloud, we identify features. This would be the feature identification or feature detection. We detect features and then we match those features. We say, okay, this feature corresponds to this, this to this, and so on. This would be the feature matching step. So feature detection and feature matching. And then we build the differences between the features X in two epochs. And therefore, we use the strategy leading to 3D vector fields. And we did a processing in several steps. At first, we transformed the point clouds, each point cloud, to an image. So we rasterized it and transformed it into a digital elevation model. So we get a smooth height, let's say a smooth height of the point in the point cloud. And this looks like the one you see here. So you can see here the difference between point cloud 2014 and point cloud 2016 after we transformed it to a digital elevation model and created a relief using hill shading technique. So we did a lot of smoothing to get out the curvature, because we wanted to use the curvature and the local geometric information to detect features. And now if we compare both epochs, you can see the change of both epochs quite frequently now. You see that we would visibly quite good have the chance to detect changes. And now the question is, can the computer or can the methods we use also do this? You can see much details changing, and you can see much information, much more than all the methods before. And now we want to use this information we need to detect and match to get the deformation out. And therefore, we did a feature detection, and I now just write down some methods. I will not explain them, but you can have a look at them in the literature, or if you just Google them. But we used feature detection by the min-eigen algorithm and feature matching by a local surrounding using the case feature description algorithm. And if we do this, we get thousands of features that are matched, but that are quite noisy, and we also have outliers and so on. This is why we average certain features in a certain neighborhood based on a given raster, and then we have a more accurate result and a more reliable result. So we did a gridding or vectorization or rasterization. So you can see that these blue vectors here are all rasterized, and this is the result of the feature detection and matching using 3D vector fields. So we have 3D information. These are 3D vectors representing the deformation in the region. And you see underlying in red the surface markers, and in blue are the 3D vector fields using the method based on the point clouds, based on the laser scanner point clouds. You can see that they are quite inaccurate here in the at the borders. They are not pointing into one direction, but here you can see clearly that we have an area here which moves down this direction. We have here an area, and this also matches quite well with the surface markers. But now we have much more information. We also have information in these regions where we don't have surface markers given. So we have a really high density of information with also a high accuracy that you can use to monitor the landslides or to find out if there are soliflexional processes or not. This is also the same sketch in 3D. Here you see the 3D vector fields, and you can see that indeed we have 3D information, not just 2D. This is based on a new method we invented, you can see in the paper. And here you see clearly the movement of the soliflexion. You can also now get the correct numbers, so the quantities of the movement, and this really helps to analyze the hill here considering soliflexional processes. So an interim conclusion regarding the area-based approach: we have used point cloud comparisons where you can only see the heads detectable, the bodies not, due to the fact that we have an in-plane deformation which is not sensitive for a point cloud comparison. We see differences of 20 to 70 millimeters, but those valid unit measurements are not, or those quantities are not really reliable due to the facts I already told. But we used the point cloud comparison to identify regions. We analyze the deformations using a local ICP, where also only the heads are detectable, body not. We get values between 15 to 85 millimeters. Again, not so accurate those numbers, and most probably an underestimation regarding the positional change. But we also use 3D vector fields where we have the heads and the bodies detectable, because we found features in the complete region. Based on a feature detection and feature matching strategy, we found those deformations with a high spatial resolution and also with a high accuracy. And those show that the values are larger than we saw before, based on the fact that here we can only see partly information or parts of the information we are looking for, but here we see all the information. And the accuracy is millimeter to centimeter, depending on the method. Here I would say it's rather millimeter. Here it's rather centimeter, but not well known, meaning we cannot do a valid variance propagation. We don't know the individual uncertainty of each point in the vector field of each estimated parameter in the ICP. So it's not so easy to do a significance test as it was for the point-based measurements based on a total station. So, in the end, a conclusion. I introduced the strategy to monitor the solid fluxion using total stations and a point-based method. There we have a well-known processing scheme and we know the uncertainty quite well. We have determined movements at discrete points at the surface markers that were positioned on the lobe surfaces. We have only a limited spatial resolution, so we cannot say what happened here and here and here, but we know quite well the uncertainty. The measurement accuracy is quite high if we consider the network points because we did a geodetic network. And based on those points, we can also detect even small scale deformations. If we talk about laser scanning and the point cloud comparison, we can detect changes in geometry and volume. We have an increased spatial resolution. It's not restricted to a predetermined set of marker locations. But we have the problem with the in-plane and out-of-plane deformation. Since it's in-plane, since we have planar surfaces, we can use it only limitedly. And the complete uncertainty by G of the result is hard to quantify. We cannot do a significance test here. If we do the local ICP, we get numerical values. So we get real quantities that are estimated based on the ICP. But it's also not so well usable for in-plane deformations. We have an underestimation of the deformation's magnitude, especially if the local region is not well defined. So if parts of the region we used for the local ICP deformed and parts did not deform, then we have a mixed signal in the estimated parameters, and also significance test is not really processable. In the end, using the features of the 3D vector fields, we have surface movements with high accuracy since we have a lot of averaging in this method. It's not restricted to predetermined marker locations. We rather have 1,000 features compared to 100 surface markers. It rests upon the fact that we need a surface that allows for feature detection. This is not always given, but here in this application, we could do it quite straightforward. Based on the new method, but also the complete uncertainty by G is hard to quantify, a significance test not performed here. So in the end, the question is, what should you do? What is the best strategy to monitor a solid fluxion or landslide in general? So this is not cannot be answered just by one word. The question is rather, is a combination of those measurement strategies approachable or useful, or is there a competition between those measurement strategies? I've shown that we need GNSS, total station and laser scanner, and I would say they all have advantages. We need reference points, we need local points, we need spatial information that is spatially we need much spatial information if we want to find out if something moved where we didn't assume it to move, then most probably we would not measure there with a total station. There helps a laser scanner. So a combination of several methods is, in my mind, right now the best strategy, because if we consider those strategy, we need references, we need objects in the field, we need some accurate measurements, we need some measurements with a high spatial density. So combining several types of measurements is, in my mind, a good strategy. And depending on the exact task you will have, if you want to monitor a solid fluxion, maybe you don't need a total station, or maybe no GNSS. Maybe if it's a small region, you can also use a multi-station. But in general, I think that using those laser scanner measurements or other measurements, maybe UAV with the photogrammetry, will be a good way for monitoring landslides, since most times we don't have so much information where something could happen. And if we just collect the complete data of the region, we can afterwards find out what happened. This is more easily as if we would just measure some few points and we don't have a guess if something moved in between. So I would say a combination is right now the best strategy, but anyway, or in any case, you should use also information with high spatial density, as in this case, a laser scanner, since there are many strategies by now to get out deformation out of them, as I said, by the 3D vector fields or ICP or whatever. More information about how to get deformations out of point clouds will or is given by my previous lecture that has this topic in mind. So based on today's lecture, I wanted to point out three learning objectives: how to monitor alpine solid fluxion while combining different strategies, and how to identify landslides in point clouds.